Ham Radio Now, episode 161. Yaesu system confusion. Okay, no, sorry. That's just being clever. It's not really all that confused. We'll just call it Yaesu system fusion. Yaesu system fusion is their new VHF-UHF repeater system with a combination of digital voice and analog, and their entry into the digital voice market, which is not fully operational yet, but some of it is here. And this program was intended to be a complement to the review that I did in the September issue of QST Magazine. I reviewed the FTM-400 mobile radio and the FT1DR handheld, and it was a pretty good, serious, long review. Let me point out that the review editor, get him centered there, Mark Wilson, K1RO, and then there's me down there. Mark does the review editing. He takes my copy and makes sense out of it. I sent him a very long review, and he printed a very long review, about as long as QST would be able to put in a review on something like this. I think it's almost 9 pages. It's huge. But I sent a lot more. So I'll be looking at some of those things that I put in that he had to take out just for space as I go through this program. You know, this is not one of those back-of-the-book programs. When I did the last program, 160, the Friday Night BS with Ward Silver and Bill Pasternak, I was mentioning that I think most Ham Radio Now programs sort of belong in the back of the book where the wonky stuff is. But this is a front of the book. This is radios and being on the air and stuff. So maybe this will be one of those episodes that gets more than 10,000 views. That would be cool. So I've got a couple of videos that I produced that are going to be part of this program. There's two of them. The first one will be me playing with the handheld, the FT1DR. And oh, by the way, I'm referring to a pretty extensive notes here on the Nexus 7. So apologize for looking down, but there's so much stuff crammed in here that I need my roadmap to help me get through it. So I've got a video of me playing with the FT1DR handheld through one of the Yaesu digital repeaters, the DR1. I think they call it the DR1X now. Those repeaters are not on the market yet. There's a handful of them scattered around the country that Yaesu is using as a beta test, and one of them happened to show up here with a group that I'm part of, a loose part of, in the Raleigh, North Carolina area. It came at just the right time. I had the radios from ARL for a while and was playing with them, and then the repeater popped up. So got to actually experience what the radios look like and sound like going through a repeater. So got some of that. It's a good comparison of analog and digital, because the thing about system fusion is that it has both analog and digital in the repeater. The idea is to bring the analog folks along and not get them too angry about a repeater going digital. So the repeater is pretty much a plug-in replacement for other repeaters, you know, a little bit of interfacing to a controller, but the connections to the duplexer and the antenna, all that stuff are simple. So you can take one of these repeaters, just plunk it in. Your analog users still able to talk analog, but now the folks that have bought these digital radios can play digital. I have some comments about how all that might work out and Yaesu's concept of system fusion a little bit later on in the program. The second piece of video that I've got is a comparison of other digital modes on other handy talkies. And for that, I headed down to visit some friends down in the Charlotte area. And we are comparing D-Star, P25, DMR, digital mobile radio, or MotoTRBO, no email, please. And, of course, the Yaesu C4FM. So I did this with some help of the guys who in Charlotte who are deep into, I was going to say all of the digital modes, but they're not. They don't do P25. Not interested in that. And they may or may not adopt the Yaesu stuff. We'll see. Maybe kind of overload for them. They are a Roland W9HPX, Dave KC4YPB, and Mike W4DXL. And these guys are all part of this operation, the Charlotte Digital Radio Group. They started as a D-Star group. And if you look at the web address, it's charlottedstar.org. And then when MotoTRBO became a big deal, DMR became a big deal, they added some DMR repeaters, and everybody's got D-Star radios and DMR radios, and probably wishing they could have them all in one radio, because you know their pants are falling down because of all the handy-talkies. And they're all being profiled on hamsexy.com because they got too many radios hanging on their belt. Okay, so they do D-Star, they do DMR, they don't do P25, and no C4FM as of yet. So we'll look at those videos, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about Wires X. Wires X is Yaesu's system for linking their repeaters to the internet and connecting them in worldwide communication. They've had wires for a while in analog for the analog systems. Wires X is the system that will do this C4FM, and it will also do analog. The repeaters themselves are still not on the market. They're just in that beta test. The Wires X stuff is still not on the market. And when I did the review, it was not available at all. Couldn't find out anything about it. Since then, the manual has been released. So I can't play with it, and I don't have the radios anymore. So even if it was out there to use, I couldn't play with it. But it's not, at least not here in the U.S. But I went through the manual and figured out as much as I could about what Wires X was going to do. It is on the air, fully operational in Japan. Got some YouTube video that we'll take a look at that. And now about that QST review, initially I was kind of disappointed because I was kind of hoping that it was going to point people who read the review here to Ham Radio Now. Stuck in a bunch of references to the program. And they took them all out. So I'm kind of disappointed in that, but it turns out it was kind of a good thing because the digital version of QST came out kind of early. It was, I think it was out like on the 5th or, you know, not a, a week ago, more than a week ago. And the print issue I got in the mail just a couple of days ago, but this program wasn't ready. So if they had been pointing people at Ham Radio Now, they wouldn't have found the program. So, and it turns out that, it was good that I was late. And the reason that I was late is that Freelance has been very, very good to me for the past, since field day. Came back from field day, and suddenly I was inundated by Freelance work. They hadn't been around for most of this year. So, not much time for Ham Radio Now. Freelance is feast and famine. And there's been a lot of famine this year, which means that I've gotten a lot of Ham Radio Now done. But it's been pretty much feast since field day, since the end of June. So all of July and the first part of August. And I'm not sure whether it's going to keep up or not. We'll see. My calendar for this week was absolutely empty when today began. And this is Monday, August 18th. And now 2 days are full and maybe more. So we'll see what happens. All right, let's get on with the show. Let's take a look at me playing with the handy talkie and the digital repeaters. Now, I want to emphasize this test is not scientific. It is just plain real world stuff. The circumstances are not well controlled. So you're just going to see the actual results that I got just playing with it in the real world. In fact, the guy that I'm talking to, in part of the video, Bob, KB4RGC, was you won't see this in the video, but at some point he was wagging his finger at me saying, you're not doing anything scientific. Your results are absolutely useless. So maybe, but they'll be fun to watch. This video I made with the hopes of having it embedded in QST. There are some videos embedded in the digital version of QST. They didn't. They did have this in time, but they weren't able to do it because videos embedded in QST, which seems like a very cool idea, and like, well, it's, you know, it's the internet. You should be able to put as much stuff as you want. It should be practically infinite. But the digital QST is downloadable, something you can bring down to your hard drive, and they want to keep the size reasonable. As it turns out, it's somewhere between 300 and 400 megabytes. Without the video, it would be less than 100 megabytes. It would be pretty tiny, maybe way less than 100 megabytes. So they limit how much video they put in. Now, video all across the board is the bandwidth hog and the file size hog. It's just huge. It's a lot smaller than it used to be, but it's still relatively huge. So they didn't put it in there. They do have their own video of the of Bob Allison playing with the FT-400, the mobile radio. So you'll see a special for QST title in there. I decided to leave that in just because it was already there and it was kind of cute. I hope they don't mind. All right, let's look at me sitting right here, wearing a jacket, because I did this back when it was winter and cold in North Carolina. And we'll play with the handy talkie and the digital repeater. So I've got the Yaesu handy talkie here, and I am going to be going through a local repeater that happens to have the Yaesu digital repeater under test. Well, here's the setup. There's the control head sitting there. Here's the handy talkie. I've got microphone in front of the speaker over there. So I've got the HT on the lowest power setting. I'm about 7 or 8 miles from the repeater. So in the 100 milliwatt setting, I should be plenty noisy. There's the repeater IDing. I'll also need to do something that is important when you're doing a strength test to a repeater, and that is to move the HT around a little bit and find where the multipath nulls and peaks are, and make sure that if I'm switching modes, that I don't go from a null to a peak. So here's what it sounds like. Going for a IQ test now. Okay, one little hot spot right there. Now switch to digital. All right, this is a test. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
3, 4, 5. PM4RQ testing. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Switch to analog. Setting the switch to digital wide.
There's digital wide.
Which sounds a little bit better. In theory, less error correction, at least that's what I've heard people say. So let's see what the analog signal sounds like now.
Okay, there's my analog signal. KN4EQ testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
And the digital signal.
So it garbles similar to the star, although maybe a little bit less of a threshold. It just kind of disappears a little faster. It still makes pretty good yowl.
Hey Gary, KB4RGC, digital is a little bit beyond the threshold.
Hey Bob. Well, I can hear myself loud and clear. Yeah, I've got the handy talkie playing through the base station
into a repeater, and I'm shooting a little video, but this can play your signal too. So let's see what you sound like. Okay, Gary, you must have changed something. Now you're back to very good audio.
I changed my position.
About an inch or two.
And there it goes away, and now
okay,
it's...
Okay, you fine-tuned to the sweet spot.
Yeah, it's only about an inch or two.
Let me see what the analog signal sounds like here.
There's the sweet spot, and here's where it goes away. So that's an interesting comparison.
Yeah, actually, when you switched from analog to digital, it was really very apparent how much more pleasant the digital signal sounds like. On FM, there was a lot of white noise on it and fading, and the moment you switched over to digital, it was pleasant to listen to.
Thanks, Bob.
See you at the Hamfest. Game 42.
Okay, once again, not a controlled scientific experiment, just me playing in the real world. And Bob, thanks for talking to me for a minute. Now, let's go on to that comparison of the other digital modes, D-Star, C4FM, P25, and DMR. Again, it is not scientific. It is just a bunch of hams playing with the radios. And as you'll discover as you watch this, and this will be a longer video, it is not very well coordinated. I sent Roland and Mike out to the remote location. I did not send a producer with them because I didn't have a producer to send with them. So they just did their best. And I guess we'll find out what a producer does. Roland wasn't holding his radios very close to the camera, so you don't hear them very well. In fact, you hear a bird in a tree behind the camera a whole lot better than you hear the radio, and almost better than you hear Roland and Mike. We also discovered that, well, we wanted to go to the edge of communications range. The big thing about these radios, besides the way they sound and the flexibility that you have with their modes, is the way they perform at the fringe. The idea of digital, you know, this idea that the signal stays crisp and clear and no noise or anything until you reach the threshold and then they just disappear. Well, that doesn't really happen. It gets close. Something like that happens, but not quite, and you'll hear more of it. You probably heard some of it before, but you'll hear more of it now. But when you reach the edge of communications range, it can be hard to communicate. And I didn't make a solid logistics communications path where I could tell them what I wanted them to do and what they could tell me what they were going to do and things like that. We were just using whatever communications we had for the demonstration, and they were at the fringe, so it was kind of in and out. Things were not very well coordinated. I could have set up a crossband repeater from my car, which was sitting in the parking lot not too far away, but I didn't. You know, there may be a lesson here in this communicating at the fringe for other activities that we coordinate using our radios. I'm thinking of Aries and Hamfests and Field Day, things like that. I have noticed in my long career and participation in ham radio activities that too often there's too much confusion about how we are going to communicate. We have lots of choices. We don't always agree or choose the best one, or sometimes we don't even choose at all. But that's a story for another program. But I want to add one more thing. One great example of that is a lot of times we'll be at some event, Hamfest or something, where a bunch of us are going to go off to dinner. We're going to travel down the road a few miles and go to dinner, maybe 5 or 6 or 7 cars worth of hams. And not all that sure where we're going to go, and be some navigating involved. And so we need to be communicating with each other. And we always end up on 146.52. And somebody doesn't manage to make it there, and they get left out for whatever reason. And when someone is out of earshot, out of physical contact, and they disappear from the radio, well, they're pretty much gone. I suppose you can call them on a phone. We never swap cell phone numbers because we got ham radio to communicate on. Well, somebody always disappears. We always try to end up on 5-2 because we can't get anything else put together as the least common denominator. So that's what we do. Where was I? Oh, story for another program. Certainly is. Anyway, I decided to leave most of that confusion in the video. I did eliminate a lot of stuff that just kind of closes up time where nothing was going on. But otherwise, you're going to see things warts and all. Watch particularly when I call to the other guys to switch to the Yaesu radios. I think we started with D-Star and then we went to Yaesu. And you'll see that Roland and Mike didn't get their cue. They switched to DMR. We switched to Yaesu, and it takes a few minutes to get back in sync. And I also want to mention something else, the concept of multipath. If you are comparing things with RF, and you don't have antennas that are locked down, you don't have the same antenna always in the plan, you're not using one antenna for everything, then you've got the problem on VHF and UHF, the problem of multipath, where signals bounce off and add and subtract from each other as you move them around. And you don't have to move around very much. You take a handy talkie, and you probably experienced this. You move it just a few inches around, and signals at the margins will fade in and out. So you have to account for that. You'll see us trying to account for that as we do the program. All right. Let's head down to Charlotte, North Carolina, and we'll look at the guys and me playing with multiple digital formats of handy talkies in a non-scientific, just the way you might see it in real life, comparison. So we're going to do this like home movies. This is just a single camera, the microphone's there on the camera, none of my fancy stuff. So this is our test. This is my test crew. Introduce yourselves, test crew. Roland?
I'm Roland, W9HPX.
I'm Dave, KC4YPB.
Mike, W4DXL.
And these guys, one's going to stay here with me, two are going to head out into the field. We're going to test a bunch of radios. I got here the Yaesu FT1DRM, not DRM, sorry. I got a P25 radio, Johnson. We got a bunch of D-Star radios. You got
ID, yep, 91
and a ID 92.
51. IC 91.
And the 51. And then you got a MotoTRBO radio.
There's a MotoTRBO.
Which you didn't bring.
Which I didn't bring.
Okay. So
very good.
We're just going to play on Simplex. We're gonna head out probably about 4 or 5 miles away. We'll be at the 4 to 5 watt level depending on what the radios will do. And we're mostly going to look and see what the radios sound like and how they perform at the fringe, just as the signal level is disappearing. That's the deal with digital. We'll listen to analog, we'll listen to digital in the various different formats and see how they compare. So off you guys go. Find something 5 miles away. I'm going to record a little bit here while you guys are driving. I guess the deal is you're going to drive until you reach the cliff. We're talking on D-Star, and when you fade out, you'll stop driving. How copy now?
Yeah, that's a good plan. I copy very well, and we have not gotten all that far yet. We're in some traffic.
So while we're waiting for those guys, and while the ambulance is going by, we'll show you the Yaesu FT1D compared to an ICOM 51 side by side. And they're about the same size. The ICOM's a little bit taller, but the Yaesu's got a full keyboard on it. Hold them sideways now. Hang on to them both. So about the same thickness.
W9HPX. We made it through the traffic signal and we're moving. So how's the signal strength?
Still excellent, Roland. Still excellent. Thank you.
So he's still too strong. He's
okay,
got to go farther away.
Still getting a good signal on you, Dave. Okay, we're turning into the parking lot. The signal strength in the car on K51 is only down to a single bar, so it's fairly low.
Okay, at whatever point you wish to pull over and we'll make the test, that's fine with me.
And come up real close.
Okay, let's get in the picture.
So we can get it. Oh, okay. There we go.
Roland, KC4YPB, how do I make this do analog as opposed to digital?
Yeah, you press the mode button, that's the middle left, until...
Got it.
KC4YP.
I can copy you. Go ahead.
Roger. This is
the ID51 analog.
And I'm receiving you
With a fair amount of noise. One indicator on the S meter display. So for FM, where if we go a little further, we'll probably drop out entirely.
Roger, on analog for about 30
seconds. I'll wave it around and you stand still and see if you pick up any of the peaks or anything like that.
All right, well, I'm moving around just a little bit.
As you were transmitting, I did, and I could get, you know, 2 bars on my S-meter, but it doesn't take much movement to
get a change in the signal. Go ahead. KC4YPBW9HPX on digital voice D-Star.
I think we've done one. If you do the 30-second thing again, we'd appreciate it, sir.
The digital,
D-Star
digital.
Okay, Dave, we're on D-Star digital voice here.
And I'm just moving around a little bit.
Giving you a chance to see if the signal changes much. How's that?
I'm surprised, and the audio quality at that distance considerably better than analog was, which, by the way, you'd expect.
Yes, that's exactly what I would expect also, and that's what I observed.
Okay, let's try it on the Yaesus.
Okay, Roland, this is the Yaesu KC4YPB. Can you copy?
Oh, that's probably the turbo.
KC4YPBW9HPX. I am on the CS700 DMR radio, but I am in the FM mode.
Is the volume turned down? W4MPX, KC4YPB.
KC4YPBW9HPX. I'm in DMR on the CS700 radio.
Roland, this is Dave on the Yaesu. Can you copy KC4YPB?
Seem to have lost them.
Raise them in there.
Dave, you're still around. This is W4DXM.
I am on D-Star. I was trying on the other radio also. Were you not able to copy?
No, we did not hear you. What were you on again?
I was trying on the Yaesu.
Trying on the Yaesu. Sorry, we didn't have that radio. Hang on, please.
That might account for some of it.
It would, yeah. I realize one of the limiting factors we've done is we push people out to the limits of communication. It's hard to communicate.
AN4AQ
or KC4YPD. And on their digital mode.
Okay, this is the
Yaesu here on digital mode also. KC4YPD, can you copy?
Copy you very well.
Good clear signal, no noise.
Roger, so if you do the 30 seconds thing and stand still, we'll do the moving here.
Okay.
I saw you move a little bit. I'm getting, you know, 1 bar maybe. How are you copying me?
Yeah, 30 seconds. Want to give a little more sound?
All right.
I'm on the A1D. I'm in digital, and
let me move just a little bit back and
forth. Tell me how you copied me. Go ahead.
Copy you just fine. We had one dropout on radio one, but we didn't copy it.
The audio quality is good on this.
Okay, on that transmission, I heard some.
Some digital artifacts. In other words, it was starting to break up a little bit. I was moving around a little bit, but so we're right at the edge for the Yaesu radio.
Okay, let's switch these radios to analog, which I don't think I told them how to do.
Do you know how to switch that one to analog? If not, I'll try to give you some instruction.
Now, how do I put this in FM?
I'm not going to do it until you.
Yeah, it's the button mark DX.
Yeah. Roland, did you copy KC4YPB? Do you know how to switch it to analog? If not, I'll try to give you a little tutorial.
Go ahead, give me the tutorial. Okay.
Come back with what you said. I did not copy what you said, sir.
Give me the tutorial, please.
He said give him the directions.
Roger, if you look on the left-hand side of the keyboard, there's three red buttons. At the top one, it says DX on it. And I think if you toggle that one, it'll toggle between analog, digital, and narrow FM, and wide FM, and WD for wide, I assume. So try that until you get to FM, and I'll try to meet you there. Okay,
so we'll put it now. FM, okay. KC4YPB-W9HPX in FM on the Yaesu.
FM, there it is.
KC4YPB-W9HPX in FM.
I copy you, but it's not. KC4YPB, copy me, rolling.
All right, Dave, it was very noisy, and mostly it was not enough to break the squelch on the radio.
Roger, I copied you a little bit better here than what I was expecting you to be.
It's not very good at all.
Yeah, I disabled the squelch and I could hear you, but it was mostly noise. Very difficult to understand your audio. So we are at the edge for FM and probably also the edge for digital on the Yaesu.
That's true, but while we are on the edge for digital, it does have better audio clarity, in my opinion, than does the FM. That's just my personal opinion.
Well, and it's my opinion also. The FM was too much noise to really be that clear. Yes, you could pick out the audio. In an emergency, you would do that. But the digital really came through pretty much clear. A breakup once in a while, but not very serious.
Okay, let's do
P25. Yeah, let's do P25. Well, that didn't work so well. We had some trouble getting things started. So we used D-Star to coordinate, and we finally had to switch these Johnson radios over to analog to be able to find each other.
KC4YPB-W4DXR.
Roger, I copied you with a little static on the background. Try it again. KC4YPB.
KC4YPB-W4DXR.
Copy marginal. There's a little bit of static,
quite a bit of static on your signal. Not too far from the fringe on this one either.
Okay, I'm having to hold this radio up in the air and not close to me compared to the tests we did with the other radios. Over.
Right, now that
transmission was absolutely clear. Very good for analog at this distance. Actually, the best analog I've heard yet.
But you'd expect that.
Okay.
Yours has been pretty good, although I wouldn't say it was really better than the other two.
Roger, just for chucks and giggles, let's try channel one again for the P25.
Okay, I'm going to hold the radio in the same position.
See, these are all Motorola components right here.
KC4YPB-W4DXL, how copy?
Okay, Roland.
Hey, Roland. KC4YPB, are you able to copy, sir?
You've got W4DXL, Dave, and perfect copy.
Absolutely,
absolutely perfect copy here also. That's B25. That's a very clear... Again.
Okay,
I have to hold the radio up in the air to hear you on P25. If I do the test where we did the tests with the other radios, you go out completely.
Okay, if you'll give me about a 30-second transmission, please.
And we'll do the radio moving here on this end and see what we accomplish. Casey.
And he went away.
Okay, you dropped out there. But I did hear that you're going to move around, so go ahead. W4DXL.
You stopped talking too soon.
He's not stopped. He's still talking.
I think he stopped.
Did you stop talking, or are you still going?
No, I stopped talking. You said you were going to move around. And I thought you were going to transmit. I guess you're moving around, doing receive now. This is W4DXL with an informal test of the turbo
radio, known as DMR.
P20.
Sorry.
Getting my radios mixed up here.
Very broken.
Yep, but about the same kind of, a few dead spots.
There's not really a lot of difference between the two.
No.
But the prettiest sounding analog was the commercial radio, which you would expect.
It's got the biggest speaker.
Right. That's exactly right.
I think I disagree with myself. After editing this segment and being able to see and hear both sides of the conversation, I think P25 was clearly worse. At least the Johnsons were clearly worse, but both analog and digital. But that's not an indictment of P25. It's not a declaration that D-Star or C4 FM are better. We didn't put any of these radios on signal generators to measure their sensitivity. We didn't do any antenna measurements. I did put some of them on a bird watt meter. The ICOM and Yaesu radios are 5 watts. The Johnson is 4 watts. I think the C4 FM you'll see, or the DMR you'll see, is 4 watts coming up. The Johnson antenna is not cut for the ham bands. I'll take a close-up look at this here. And we'll compare it to the antenna on my 92AD. The Johnson antenna is much, much shorter. It's designed to be broadband, to cover all of the commercial spectrum above the ham band from 450 to 470, and theoretically down into the ham band down to about 440. That's 30 megahertz wide. I don't know how they do that magic. And I suspect they don't do it perfectly. So that may account for the poorer performance of the Johnson radios, but I really don't have the measurement capabilities to tell. I also noticed that D-Star and Yaesu's C4 FM did some, I'm going to call it yelping, when the signal got really weak and at the end of a transmission. P25 exhibited more of that digital cliff where the signal is just there and then it goes away with no significant amount of garble at the very end. All right, last but not least is DMR or MotoTRBO. And here we have one Motorola radio in the mix, so it truly is MotoTRBO. And the other radio is one of those Connect System CSI 700 radios, so it's just DMR, not MotoTRBO. These radios, as it turned out, did not have any simplex programmed into them. And we thought we weren't going to be able to use them, and then the guys realized they could do something called talk around, something the radios are theoretically capable of doing. Talk around is a commercial term for doing simplex on the output of a repeater. And it, assuming that everybody who's using the radios understands the concept well enough, if you go out of range of a repeater, but you're still close enough for simplex with someone, you haven't totally lost your radio system, you can still talk directly to them. Or if the repeater goes down, you can still talk directly to them. So we use talk around, the simplex on the output of one of the local repeaters, or at least we tried to, and that seemed to have its own unique problems because it was difficult to tell if one of our signals was actually going through a repeater or was on talk around, because the repeater doesn't really add anything to the mix except for making things go farther. So anyway, here's the DMR part of our demonstration.
Turbo. Did you pick him up that time, Dave?
I picked him up. I'm not sure he's talking on simplex. It almost sounds like he's actually on the repeater, but I could be wrong.
He's on what he calls talk around?
Yep.
He said it sounds like you're on the repeater.
Well, but that's what you'd expect out of digital.
Okay. We're not hearing him.
The problem with digital, they all sound the same.
Yeah.
KC4YPB.
KC4YPB. Can you copy, sir?
I may have my radio program.
Is there any hang time or anything coming back from the repeater on DMR that tells you you're into the repeater?
We usually... No. Yes, there is, but there's nothing coming back, so there's no signal strength coming back.
KC4YPB W9HPX, give me some talk, David, if you can.
This is KC4YPB. I'm on the simplex side of the Crowder's repeater, KC4YPB.
So you are not on talk around?
I am on talk.
That sign right there indicates talk.
Okay, I'm receiving you. I had a little bit of break up there just for half a second. I'm on talk around 2, which is the same as simplex on the output frequency of the repeater. And we're just at the limit of digital on DMR at this location.
Yeah, as far as I'm concerned, keep talking for a while.
If you don't mind,
just keep talking for a while, because this person we're in about broken here.
If you don't mind, I could move around a little bit, and you would drop out.
And I'm moving now as I transmit.
So you may get some drop out on me.
But it is crystal clear as long as it's within the capture range of the digital signal.
Well, if I move, Dave, I can get into a spot where you drop out. So when I do have you in, I get only one bar. But this signal strength meter on this radio doesn't have nearly the resolution.
Oh, we found one little dead spot.
Yep.
Okay, is there an analog mode on that? It's a challenge.
Yeah. No, yes, there is, but it has to be programmed separately.
Okay.
I have no programming for analog. You still there, Roland? KC4YPB, I got one dropout on you. One dropout on me.
That was after laying the antenna horizontal and then going slightly south with it. That was the only time I was able to get a break at all.
Okay, I think your radio may be a little more sensitive on receive than my radio.
Yeah, are you at high power? Mm-hmm. Okay. And there are they 5 watt or 4 watt or?
This is 4, and so is his.
Okay.
Yeah. Apples for apples.
It seems like the D stars aren't as. Mm-hmm. Okay, now I think we can call him back.
Bad about placement. Okay, they seem to capture.
I need a repeat on that. Dave, give me a repeat on that, please.
Time to come back. Come on back. Ask him to go back to D-Star.
Can you go back to D-Star for a minute?
KC4YPB W4DXL. KC4YPB W4DXL.
It's KC4YPB. Go ahead, sir.
Okay. How are we doing over there on the D-Star radio? Because I'm sensing that the D-Star is a little less critical in terms of radio placement at this location. I'm going to move around a little bit. If you would just give me a 10 count.
Roger, well, instead of a 10, let me just talk for a little while. Give us a wagon or head on back.
That told me just what I needed to know.
Placement is critical with the D-Star as well. We just happen to be in a sweet spot. This is a pretty good testing location. We're headed back your way, W4DXL. Thank you.
Which Motorola radio is
this
that?
This is the XPR7550.
Okay.
Okay, we got to get you into
it. Here I am. So that clearly was not a laboratory-grade test, I believe you would all agree.
But it was fun. We had a good time.
Yeah. Any conclusions or impressions?
The impressions between the digital modes we tried is there isn't a lot of difference.
No.
I think.
Yeah, signals were about the same. We were at the minimum level of signal for everybody, and we could find some dead spots as you were moving around. And everybody had about the same dead spots. The DMR, MotoTRBO-ish DMR, had maybe the fewest dead spots, but by a little. By the way, do you guys say DMR or do you say MotoTRBO?
Both.
I say DMR because that's the platform. MotoTRBO is the manufacturer.
In other words, if you own a Motorola radio, you say MotoTRBO.
Oh, of course.
And if you own anything else, you say DMR.
Yeah.
All right. So but what do you think about the Yaesu thing?
Sounded good. It sounded digitally, it sounded the same as the others.
Yeah.
Essentially. I think the biggest conclusion you can draw from this test, though, is the difference between analog and digital. At the same points on the raggedy edge, the digital is so much clearer.
Yeah.
And there is so much noise that sometimes you can't pull the audio out of the FM.
The digital breakup on the Yaesu sounded a bit different than the digital breakup we're used to hearing on the Icon.
Everybody's got their own,
Yeah, I can't explain it, but it's like a signature almost.
Yep. And to me, the D-Star is kind of the worst, because it's got that R2-D2 thing that nobody else seems to have.
Kind of high-pitched.
Yeah. Yeah, and they can trail off for a long time. Mm-hmm. On repeaters, I've never heard that on Simplex, but on repeaters, I've heard it, you know, bobble for a long time after someone stops talking. Don't have enough experience on the Yaesu repeaters. Never heard that on a P25, and have you guys ever heard that on a DMR repeater?
No, you have a packet loss occasionally, but you don't have the R2-D2 at all.
The DMR seems to recover more readily than the D-Star does.
All right. Thanks, Dave, Mike, and Roland. Appreciate that. Interesting stuff. Once again, not scientific, not a planned and controlled environment, just hams playing with radios. But I think you can get something out of it, some understanding of how things work. And once again, don't give too many demerits to the P25 because it seemed to be the worst. Perhaps many reasons for that had nothing to do with the mode itself. We'll see. Okay, on to that big QST article. This the one here in the September issue. They put a lot into it. A lot of space in QST, so I've got no complaints about that. It had to be edited, but there was a lot of stuff that I wrote that they weren't able to fit in. Some of it is worth getting out there. So I compared the article that got published with the draft that I wrote, and I pulled out some of the missing pieces, and I thought you might hear them. First is the display of the radio. It is a touchscreen, and I compared it with a touchscreen phone. And found it somewhat lacking. It took a fairly solid poke to get it to respond. I don't have one of those radios here, so I can't play with it right now. It took a pretty solid poke to get it to respond. What they cut out, and that was in the article, what they cut out was my observation that this display looks kind of quaint in today's Android and iOS world. You know, it's fairly low resolution. It's mostly boxes and text. So if you compare it to a smartphone, you know, it kind of old feeling. The boxes and text do have some shading in them, and they gives them some apparent depth. And I'm going to see if I can dig up some pictures to stick in here while I'm talking into the camera, and I'll do that in post-production. If you're seeing pictures, you know I did some post on this. Next, QST included my comment that the GPS receiver didn't seem to be all that sensitive. But what they didn't have room for was a picture, and I've got a picture, and actually that kind of shows you some of the display as well. This picture compares the GPS display of the FTM-400 mobile radio with the GPS display of my Nexus 7 tablet. And what you can see here is that the GPS display, these are the satellites it should be seeing, but this is the only one that it is actually getting information from. And we look over here on the Nexus 7, these are all the GPS signals that it has got a good solid lock from. these would be green here, but just kind of got blown out by the camera. So it's the Nexus 7 sitting right next to the FTM-400, seeing lots more GPS signals. Where this is taking place is, well, it's really right behind me here. On the second floor of a typical wood frame house with, well, it's a brick house, but it's not a metal-sided house. The roof is typical, you know, wood and shingle. So, and it's we're only a few feet away from the roof. So, most modern day GPS devices see plenty of satellites through that, but the FTM-400 GPS receiver was not. Okay, next. They skipped my editorial, something that I put in just about every article that I think has only been published once, about how manufacturers need to do a better job handling tone. And that's, you know, CTCSS or PL or subaudible tone. Tone is trouble for travelers. Most hams have gotten the local tone figured out. We went for decades with hams complaining whenever a repeater went to some form of tone access. And that's more than half the repeaters in the country these days are doing tone access. And they pretty much have to, or there'll be a lot of interference, or at least awareness of signals from the next repeater down the road, 100 to 120 miles away or so, when the band opens up, typically is the problem. And you'd be hearing those repeaters. We can't put repeaters far enough apart so that when the band opens, even a little bit, you don't hear the users of your co-channel repeater down the road, your neighbor, you know, 100 miles away. So tone helps at least cover that up. It's a masking function. It's not a problem solver, other than if you think masking it is a solution to the problem. So a lot of repeaters require you to send tone. And if you're traveling, that can be a problem, figuring out what the tone is and being able to access the repeaters. There aren't any good, complete, overall solutions for that. But this radio doesn't even try. It doesn't even have tone scan to figure out what the tone is for a repeater that you're listening to. What I would like to see is that every manufacturer puts in something that when you tune in a repeater that is sending a tone, the radio does the work for you. So when you're driving, particularly, you don't have to do anything else. The radio says, ah, there's a tone. I'm going to set that tone into my transmitter. I'll know what the tone is, and I will turn it on and set it so the next time you transmit, you're going to send that tone. That doesn't solve every problem. It doesn't solve the problem of, well, if the repeater is not busy, if it's not transmitting, you don't know what it is. If the repeater is not sending tone, doesn't help at all. And there are a very few repeaters that send one tone but require a different tone for access of the repeater. There are some reasons to do that, technical reasons. I'm not going to go into that right now. All of those things are more rare situations. Most repeaters that require tone send the tone. And if the radio could then decode it and set it up in the transmitter without any operator intervention. Oh, sure, you have to have an override for that. So say, don't do that for me. I don't want you to do that for me. You have to have that turn off. But I think it would be good to do. And I put that in every review that I write. And like I say, I think it made it in one review for one radio. So doesn't make it all that often. Pager mode. Pager mode exists in these radios, in the FTM-400 and the FT1DR handy talkies, and I think a few other newer Yaesu radios. It's one of those things that you coordinate with someone else and you set some numbers in your radio, and when you transmit, those numbers come up in their radio, and they can tell that it was you sending the transmission, if you've got all those numbers coordinated. So that part made it to the article, but they didn't explain how it worked, and it was kind of cute. The manual also doesn't really explain how it works, but it just took a little bit of sleuthing to figure it out. What they do for this pager mode is they sequence two subaudible tones, about a half second each. So if you turn the radio way up, put it right up by your ear, maybe plug it into a speaker that's got some better low-frequency response, what you hear sounds kind of like a very low-pitched French police car siren. You know those European siren sound? At the low pitch of subaudible tone, it would be like, boo-bee, boo-bee, boo booby. It's very strange. That's how they do it. So you got to transmit for a while. It booby, booby has to be received and decoded. So it takes a few seconds. And then your number pops up on the display of the other radio. It's one of those things that you have to have the right radios to use it. I think only a few Yaesu models, current Yaesu models, have it. Other manufacturers don't get to play. Even older Yaesu radios don't get to play. I've got a bunch of Yaesu 8900 quad band mobiles. They don't get to play with this pager mode. It's also the kind of thing that hams just don't use. There have been touch tone versions of this pager mode where you can have a radio send beep, 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 and the other radio decodes it and your numbers pop up once again if you've got all that stuff coordinated between you and whoever else you're doing it with. Nobody used that. They finally took it out of most radios. They included my commentary about how important repeaters are when D-Star was launched, and they will be important when C4FM is fully launched. Next to useless to have these modes with radios that can only talk to people on simplex. I mean, FM would be pretty much useless. Nobody would pay hundreds of dollars for these little handy talkies if the only coverage that we had was what we got with simplex. So repeaters are pretty much necessary, and digital repeaters are necessary for this digital. So ICOM was smart. When they introduced the D-Star system back in around 2000, and only on 1200 megahertz at that point, but they introduced it with the radio and the repeater and the internet linking system. So all the pieces were available to make that work. And then when they expanded it in about, I think, 2004 or so, to VHF and UHF, once again, repeaters came along, the controllers, the whole internet linking thing. So when people put them up, they would be able to talk more than just simplex and, in fact, link them out to the rest of the world and have more activity than just the three or four guys that bought the D-Star radio. So and a good example of that is Alenco. Alenco actually produced the first digital radios before D-Star was launched, but no repeaters, no infrastructure. So nobody was particularly interested. They didn't sell lots of them. Kudos to them for doing that. I think you can even still buy them and buy the boards you can stick into a radio to make some of the radios digital, but no repeaters. So Alenco is not the thing. They dropped my point, though, about exclusivity. And this was a thing that happened with D-Star. Some clubs would replace an analog repeater with a D-Star repeater, and that made some of their members mad. Now, likely they didn't replace the only repeater they had with a D-Star repeater. That would have really made their members mad. But if they had a second or third repeater and it was analog and it wasn't very busy, and they replaced it with a digital repeater, hams will still get mad because there's this FOMO thing, this fear of missing out. You're hearing the digital signal, you know a couple guys are talking, you can't understand them, you can't talk back. You kind of get mad. And that's kind of the whole system fusion concept for Yaesu. The idea that the analog folks won't be left out. You buy the Yaesu repeater, you replace whatever you had before, you know, maybe an old Motorola Micor or a GE or, you know, RCA or whatever, you know, something that came out of a taxi cab 50 years ago and you've been limping along ever since. You put in one of these brand new DR1 repeaters and the analog guys can still play. And the few folks that buy the digital radios can play with digital. So that's what system fusion is all about. The analog folks are not left out. But how is that going to work? Well, when two digital people are talking, the analog folks are not going to be able to understand them. They are still going to feel left out. Not as left out as if digital was the only thing that the repeater did, but they'll still feel somewhat left out. And we've yet to see whether very many club members get mad, especially if the digital guys end up occupying the repeater for you know, tens of minutes, maybe not hours, but tens of minutes on end. There's something else that you have to consider when you do this digital thing. And that is that just like any other digital mode, if you listen to it on an analog receiver, it sounds like and a little bit of a buzz component. not pleasant to listen to, loud. So you've got a repeater that may be analog some of the time. So people are listening on analog radios, but maybe digital some of the time. And the folks listening on analog radios don't want to hear the digital noise, and they don't want to have to tune away to another frequency or turn off their radio when it's in use for digital. The solution for that, and P25 repeaters have been analog and digital together for a long time. The solution for that is that when the repeater is operating analog, it sends a subaudible tone. And when it's operating in digital, of course, it does not. So each user, each club member or each repeater user has to turn on subaudible tone decode on the radio so that the radio stays quiet when the repeater is active in digital mode. And subaudible tone decode is not something that we are highly practiced at. Like I say, it took a couple of decades before we got the hang of encode. And we are not there for decode. Now, I've mentioned this on programs before, and I've gotten some email that says, yes, hams know how to use decode. It's in everybody's radio that's less than 20 years old. And I disagree. I don't think hams are that familiar with and that practiced with using decode. So there'll still be something of an education campaign. Maybe not quite as extensive as the subaudible tone education campaign when repeaters first go tone access, but still some education for figuring out the decode part. And now back to the QST. There's a subhead called Other Digital Capabilities of the handy talkie and the mobile radio. And that a lot of that got dropped. A lot got dropped from that, including an editorial that I wrote, and I want to read to you here. Little sub-editorial embedded in the article. I want to needle the FCC and the rules that continue to make the distinction between phone and data when it comes to digital signals. If you need any more evidence that bits is bits, take apart the D-star signal. And I learned this from a talk given by Robin Cutshaw, AA4RC, the guy that invented the DV dongle, at one of the first D-Star forums that I attended in Dayton. And you can see that. It's on the web.
You can see in there, there's my call and your call, and there's voice and data. When they say simultaneous voice and data, they really mean it. It's not like you can say, well, I'm going to do just voice now, and then I'm going to do data later. Every voice and data frame alternates. So every time you key down, you're sending voice and data, whether you're plugging into your radio and sending data or not.
In any given transmission, the first couple of hundred milliseconds is spent sending bits that contain the user's call sign as data, some routing information like syncing and framing and other overhead, and then some bits fly by that are based on what you spoke into the mic, the audio being vocoded. And then some more bits fly by for other stuff. On D-Star, which sends its data at 4,800 bits per second, 2,400 bits per second are used for voice. 1,200 bits per second are used for error correction and that overhead. And another 1,200 are used for ASCII data that can be used any way you want. GPS is the stuff most people send if they've got a GPS on their radio. DRATS is the most popular program that people use to send stuff like text, small files, pictures, forms, map information. So all of that data time shares the D-Star signal serially. A little voice, a little overhead, a little GPS, a little DRATS, back to a little voice, and so on and so on. As the signal progresses, you get a little bit of each, followed by a little bit of something else, a little bit of something else, and then back to a little bit of the first thing. Bits is bits. The FCC rules don't understand that. They separate on HF in particular. VHF, UHF, not a big deal. On HF, they call one thing data, and they put that in the lower end of the band. They call something else phone, and they put that in the upper end of the band. A D-Star signal's got both. Where does it belong? Just cause the FCC to outlaw D-Star on HF, because you can't put it in either side. It's all my fault. End of editorial. The Yaesu radios have the ability to send some ASCII text too. Unlike a D-Star, you can compose and send it right from the radio using the HT's keypad or an on-screen keyboard on the mobile. With D-Star, if you want to use much of that ASCII data, you got to plug in a computer. They got a serial port, and you got to plug in something and use a program that is going to add the ASCII data to your voice. You can still talk on the radio with the microphone, and you can have that data queued up, and the radio will actually send it right along with your transmission as voice. You can say, wait till I push the button. Don't send anything until I push the button and start talking, and then add it in. It's always there. It's always using up some of your signal. Or you can automate it so that as soon as you push the go button on the computer, it turns on your transmitter and sends that data. Not a lot of people are using that, but some of the folks have really adopted D-Rats and really love playing with that. So the Yaesu radio, you can enter that information in a limited fashion right from the keyboard. On an HT, it's like pushing on an old cell phone, A-A-A-B-B-B-C-C-C, you know, putting things in torturously one character at a time. And on the mobile radio, you can bring up an on-screen keypad, and using, since it's touchscreen, you can just, you know punch on the screen what you're going to send. As I mentioned in the article, I found that it was a little hard to accurately punch in those letters. I don't have the fattest finger in the world, but evidently a little bit too fat. Plus, you have to give it a fairly good poke to get it to take. But even if it wasn't that accurate going in, it's easy to back up and overwrite and edit. So not that big a deal. It is clunky, though. It's limited to 80 characters, and so if you thought a tweet at 140 characters was limiting, 80 characters on the C4FM, it displays right on the screen of either radio, so it's a handy place to read it. But words get truncated at the end of a row. They get cut in half, and the rest of the word appears in the next row, and there's no hyphen added to enhance readability. It's not that hard to put together, but you know, it's like I say, it's a little bit clunky. So QST included all of that information, and all that is in the article. What they dropped was that this stuff is stored on a micro SD card, something you plug into either the mobile radio or the HT. And there is a delete function where you can go into the HT or the mobile and tell a message to go away. It goes away from the screen of the radio. It doesn't go away from the SD card. It is not deleted at all from the SD card. It stays there unless you reformat the SD card, which you can do from the radio, or you can plug the SD card into a computer, navigate your way to this stuff. There's nothing in the manual about how to do it, but it wasn't that hard to find. And then you can finally actually delete them. Okay, let's talk about Wires X. Wires X is, again, Yaesu's system for internet linking. And I'm going to talk about that in a minute. But first, I'm going to give you my frame of reference for all of repeater linking. The oldest repeater linking that ever existed was RF linking, with repeaters talking to each other through a second radio that is operating on RF. And we've been doing that since the beginning, since the very first repeaters appeared in the 1960s. Pretty quickly, hams added link radios and put two repeaters together. Often, 2 meters or 220 megahertz repeaters were linked using a UHF radio, and that's because using different bands avoids the desense between the repeater and the link signal. There are some ways around that, you know, by antenna separation. If you put the antennas far enough apart, you can avoid the desense. Easier to do on UHF than on 220 or 2 meters, where the bands are small and so the desense gets worse because you can't get that far away in frequency. And the FCC rules used to prohibit using 2 meters as a link band because their words were an auxiliary station. You couldn't do an auxiliary station on 2 meters. Now that's okay. There are several ways to configure these RF links. And here I had a lot of trouble with the language I want to use. I'm still not happy with what I came up with, but I'm going to give it a try. The first way is what I'll call full-time links. And the second is on-demand or dial-up links. Full-time links, two repeaters or multiple repeaters are connected all the time. You key up one, the other keys up. You don't have to do anything about it. With the on-demand or dial-up, you probably have to push some touch tones or do something that is going to connect the repeaters. Otherwise, they remain independent. Number two, and again, bad language, but I'm going to say this is how they are physically designed. It doesn't mean anything. You can link repeaters so that they go direct from one repeater to another. And that's pretty much just two repeaters. And if you do that with a single hop of linking, you're going to be limited to how far they can get apart. Now, repeaters are up on tall towers, so they go farther than your base station or mobile would, unless you happen to have a huge, you know, 400 or 500 foot tower, maybe 2,000 foot tower, maybe a mountain top or something. We're talking 100 to 150 miles, you know, given those really tall towers. Farther if you've got two repeaters on big mountaintops and no other big mountaintop in between them. The other way to do it is a backbone with multiple repeaters. So you've got repeaters with the UHF link, but that UHF link goes to some kind of a hub, or maybe it gets cascaded from one repeater to another. And now you've got lots and lots of repeaters all tied together, and you can start really extending your coverage across a state, multiple states. There are some repeater linking systems, particularly out west, that I was familiar with that covered just about all of California, kind of eased into Arizona and maybe up the coast a bit. So you can really make some coverage and stay all on RF. You can give users control of these things by touch tone, or they can be all controlled just by control operators. So moving on, in March of time, late 1990s, I think, internet linking got started. The ones I'm familiar with are IRLP, the Internet Radio Linking Project, and Echolink. There's a few others that I've heard of. I'm not very familiar with them. All-Star is one. I've heard about the WIN system. The WIN system I did a little research on. It's kind of a hybrid between RF linking and IRLP. It's not a thing unto itself, like IRLP and Echolink are, but it kind of uses both. There's Yaesu's original wire system, which is their analog version. And there's also two topologies to this, just like with RF linking. You go direct repeater to repeater, except now you're using the internet to connect things. Or you can use something that brings multiple repeaters together. IRLP calls it reflectors. Echolink calls it conferences. Same thing, different names. And multiple repeaters all tied together. Once again, a user may be able to decide how their local repeater is going to access all of this using touch tones, or it may be set up with just a control operator. It can be combined with RF linking. Local system here has got a bunch of UHF repeaters across eastern portion of the state, all RF linked together with one hub repeater that has the internet linking, so they can all use that. So you've got RF linking and internet all tied together. Echolink permits direct access from a user computer. No radios at all. IRLP requires a radio. It can be a repeater. It doesn't have to be, though. You can set up IRLP on a simplex station. They just want you to have a radio as the next step to any user. They don't want access directly from anybody's computer. All right, in 2000, again, D-Star appeared on 1200 megahertz, expanding the VHF and UHF in about 2004. D-Star's original system for linking was what they call call sign routing. It didn't set up what you think of, if you're familiar with repeater linking, as a link. It didn't connect two repeaters together in the fairly traditional sense. Based on some information that you programmed into your radio, every time you push the button, it set up a route between two repeaters. So you transmit, it looks at some stuff, not going to go into detail about how it does that, and routes your signal through the internet to another repeater and pops up on that repeater. The repeaters are not linked. As soon as you let go, it evaporates. And the person you're talking to on the other end has to program some stuff into their radio. They transmit that routing. I won't call it linking. That routing is recreated the other direction, and you hear them. They stop transmitting. It evaporates. D plus a few years later, but hams didn't like that. They said, that's dumb. It's got some interesting capabilities, but it was clunky to use. I remember talks at D-Star forums where the guys from the U.S. were trying to convince the engineers from Japan who designed all that stuff that we want something more traditional. And they didn't get it. They liked the way the system worked. It apparently worked for them in Japan just fine. So Robin Cutshaw, AA4RC, invented D+, which gave us traditional repeater linking, one repeater to another. Set up a link, it stays set up. Anybody talking on one is heard on the other. And he added the reflectors or the conferencing. They call it reflectors in D-Star, so multiple repeaters could be tied together. And anybody transmits on one is heard on all the others. So we've had all that going on for a long time. Once again, these things can be set up by the user. The user can plug some stuff into the radio and set these links up, or the control operator can and just leave it. And the user just uses whatever got set up. So now, back to Yaesu and wires. Thought we were never going to get back there. As I said, there's been an analog version of wires for a long time. It's been most popular in Japan. There are a few systems in the U.S. and other ones around the world, but most of wires has been in Japan. And when I wrote the review, there was not only no Wires X stuff on the market, there was no information, no hardware. The manual for the FTM-400 mobile and the handy talkies pointed you to the Yaesu website to get the Wires X manual, but the manual didn't exist yet. It recently appeared. So I downloaded it and looked at it. And let me bring that up on screen. We can take a quick look at it. This is the Wires X manual. If you look at it carefully, it appears to say that it is the FTM-400 instruction manual, the Wires X edition. But it doesn't contain the instructions for operating the radio. It's just instructions for using the Wires X functions that are in the radio. And it's, 54 pages long. But, you know, like any manual, it's got a lot of extensive detail in it. It takes a long time to get through any specific function, so not really that much in there. It's sometimes you really get bogged down in stuff. So anyway, you can download that and take a look at the Wires X manual yourself. I'm not going to go through all of the details of using it. I'm only going to cover the basics of what I gleaned from the manual about what Wires X is going to be able to do for you. And again, there's still no hardware on the market. I've got the Universal Radio page. They often seem to have stuff first. So this is for the repeater. But no, and they got some prices for some of the pieces for it, but not the repeater. Normally they say something is not available when something is not, and here they don't. But here, with the HRI 200, that's the Wires X deal, and we'll post pricing and availability as soon as it's announced. So it is not. But this is the little box that you would plug into the repeater, or you can plug it into the FTM-400 base station and make a Wires X, what they call it, a node, is a simplex node on Wires X. So let's look what I figured out. It is on the air in Japan. So these things are available. They're being shipped. They're just not here in the U.S. yet. The basic functions are pretty much the usual stuff. You connect to your local node. The local node can be the repeater or the simplex station through that interface. And from there, you connect to other nodes through the internet or other rooms. And rooms is what Yaesu is calling the reflectors or the conferences that IRLP and D-Star use. All the same thing, once again, just different terminology. How do you get the radio to do that? Well, that gets pretty detailed, and without a radio to play with, I really couldn't follow it all in going through the manual. The step-by-step, again, always looks complex and detailed. Once you have actually learned it, in many cases, it's just bip, 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 and you get something done. Sometimes it's convoluted and very awkward, and I can't tell from here. But the basics are with the wires system, you connect to another node, another repeater someplace and talk to them, or another simplex base station someplace and talk to them. Or a room conference, get a bunch of folks, different repeaters, all talking together. The control capabilities for that exists within the radios. Again, it gets pretty detailed about how to use it, but I don't think it'll be hard to use once you're playing with it. Not sure it's something that you want to do while you're driving, but I got the impression that there were some memory capabilities that once you figure out how to put a few things together, like with D-Star, you can store it in a memory and get to it easily. Well, we'll see. We've got to wait for the radio to get there.
Come on, Bear.
Everybody likes seeing the bear. Where's that camera? There we go. It's the bear cam. If he's going to be poking at me from down below my chair, I got to put him in my lap. We'll see how long he decides to stay. You love the bear. So are there any other cool functions? Well, there goes the bear. They've got something called news. It looks like both nodes and these rooms can store text or images, and you can download them. It's probably limited to the same clunky formats as the radio-to-radio text and images are, you know, the 80 characters, words broken at the end and no hyphen. And it looks like there's a way to send that stuff up to the node and get it back down. Also, there seems to be a way to store and retrieve audio messages. Although it says you can listen to the audio, you can't store them locally on your radio. So you can basically make them play. Voice mailboxes, something that's existed in a lot of repeater controllers and analog repeater controllers for a long time. So that's pretty much my report on all of this stuff. However, I did encounter some things on the web while doing this research. So might as well take a look at that. This is a guy's review of using the FTM-400DR. So you can find that on YouTube.
Hi, my name is Paul, and my call is N1HX. I want to show you a little bit about...
So he's showing some of the functions. Again, he doesn't have the repeater to play with or the wires X or any of that, but you can take a look at it. Whoa, 27,896 views. So maybe my program will get up there. Who knows? There is a Wires X operating demo on YouTube as well. And again, this is only in Japan. So it's all in Japanese. And it is of limited use unless you speak Japanese. Watching it a few times, I got a bit of an idea what was going on. I think that the guy has his mobile radio set up that's sitting there in the background as a simplex node. And you're seeing a computer screen, which is showing the stuff that the simplex node is doing through the Wires X controller and is using his handy talkie to talk on it. There are some confusing things about this video as he's looking at the HT. Both sides of the HT, the digital side and the analog side, seem to both be doing something. I don't quite understand that. And I don't see the Wires X controller anywhere in the picture, but I think that radio is operating as a Wires X simplex node. I'm not 100% sure about that. And there we see the two frequencies that are in use, and I don't get that either. So anyway, that's the Wires X operation. You can dig that up and look at it in more detail. I found all this stuff on Yaesu's System Confusion YouTube page. Facebook page. It's not on their website, but it is on their Facebook page. I think this page is run by Yaesu. Don't know for sure. But there's a lot of stuff there. You know, nobody put on there that my review is out in QST yet. Seems like somebody should. There's a bunch of Yahoo groups and other areas where there's concentrations of people talking about the Yaesu systems and systems fusion as well. And this picture, which shows a bunch of the Wires X controllers in boxes, apparently ready to ship from some Yaesu facility. So Again, they are out there in Japan, just not here. This is a list of repeaters that are on the air in Japan. And this is something I also got from the Facebook page. So there's a bunch of them. I don't know if this is every single one of them. I mean, there's quite a few, but it's not super extensive. And not quite enough useful information to tell what's going on, although I think you're seeing various rooms that you can access. And one of the things that I sort of gleaned from the manual is that if you want to figure out where the rooms are, you kind of got to go online and look at them. It's not that different with D-Star. If you want to know what reflectors are available and you know where you can talk, you got to go online and look them up. Then you program them into your radio. So again, this is a Yaesu site, yaesu.com/jp/wiresx/id/active-room.php. You can read it there. Nothing for the U.S. yet or any other part of the world because stuff doesn't exist. So it's all Japan so far. What is there in the U.S.? Well, let's take a look at this group here. Came across this, which is a U.S.-centric site. It is apparently done, I think, by the same folks at Georgia D-Star, which run the D-Star info site, which has got a lot of good stuff on D-Star, including maps and repeater directories and information like that. So this is just getting started. They do have a repeater list. There we go. One repeater in Canada. The U.S. is separated by geography. So these repeaters, this is the one that I talked through, K4JDR in Cary. Let's look at the Northeast. A bunch more. I think these are all of the beta systems. So Yaesu actually got a lot of these out. Not a lot of them out west. You know, that's the hotbed out west. Midwest, not a lot in the Midwest. So what, the Northeast got the bulk of them. Again, I think, but I don't know for sure, that those are the repeaters that were sent out there as the beta test. And, I took some pictures during my review. Let's just take a quick look at those. This is the mobile's display showing APRS. I think this picture actually appeared in QST. And there it is, a different APRS display with my extensive rack of equipment. You know, it occurred to me, I got that big rack of equipment, and on the cover of QST, it's the public service issue. I won't comment. Somebody has a rack of equipment in their car, not quite as extensive, and it appears to be all Kenwood. And a little computer over there appears to be on their lap. My computer sits on a tray, mounted with the RAM mounts mounting system. So I've got all that and a variety of equipment. And what else have I got? I think that may be the one that appeared in QST. I needed to be able to mount this in my car, and what you see here is the little flat flange mounting bracket that comes with the radio. It also sticks out the back, and it's plugged into the CD player slot in my car's dashboard. I was a little bit worried about doing that, but it didn't seem to interfere with anything or cause a problem, so we're good there. This is something that didn't make it into QST. Not a big deal, but looking at the display, a pretty good look at the display, although the camera was getting a little bit blown out. I think this was the camera either in my Nexus 7 or in my phone. And you can see that there's some shading, but you compare, again, this display to a smartphone, and it's kind of clunky. But it is forward. It's way ahead of just about anything else going on in ham radio. But what I'm going to point out here is when you start looking at it from above, one of these selected bands, this is the band that's selected, is the transmit band. It's brighter than this one. And if you look at it from above, the lower one just about disappears. You can still see it in this picture, but if you're looking at it in real life, it's just about gone. So if you've got the radio so that the control head is mounted someplace where it's kind of below your eyesight, whatever is in the non-selected band, it can be kind of hard to see. This is the handy talkie and the microphone that has the camera in it. The camera stuff got some play in the QST article. And it's an interesting gimmick. The camera itself is right there, that little dot. With the HT, there's no way to see what you're taking a picture of. You're just kind of flying blind. With the mobile, you're still not, I don't think you're seeing a picture, but once you take the picture, it will show up in the display. They use their own picture. I sent them this, but they use their own picture in the article. What did they use? I say it's a big article. a puppy. Is it a puppy? I think. Anyway, it's cute. But not as cute as my wife Cindy, KD4ACW. And that is what the picture looks like if you just look at the file. It's about the same size. That's the real-time size that it comes out. So if I zoom in, blow it up, you can see it's not a very high-resolution picture. And it could never be because it's got to go over the air at a fairly low data rate, so you don't want to be spending 5 minutes for that picture to go by. It takes about 30 seconds to send. And that's a picture of the shack that I am currently sitting in. Right behind me. That's what it looks like going through the Yaesu system. So where am I? My editorial from the end of the review. It says read it right from the QST. So let me find that last page again. Although they cut a lot of editorial type stuff out, and they reduced this editorial some. They took a lot of excessive verbiage out. It's still pretty close to what I'm thinking about. So let me read this to you. Editorial, A New Hope. And I don't think anybody else does an editorial as part of a review. So kudos, Mark and Steve Ford and everybody at QST and ARL for letting me get this in. Not long ago, I was a little unhappy at the thought of splintering amateur radio digital voice into a bunch of incompatible formats. Now, I realize that this is the way of things. There's no question that digital moves fast and develops in many different ways. That great big plasma digital television in my living room that I bought way back in 2007 is obsolete compared to what is available today. And some of the stuff they cut out were the details of that TV. It's 720p, not 1080. Not a smart TV, just a dumb TV with a tuner. We'll still tune analog, but there's nothing on analog to receive with it. So it is obsolete. Now they're talking about 4K and even 8K. Yikes. Ham radio moves a lot slower. We are 99% analog in a 98% digital world in just about all of our communications medium. We won't change overnight, but at least some of our future will be tied to digital. And we can't get there with radios that do only one form of digital and never anything else. Yaesu says that their C4FM is better and newer, but how long until someone else introduces the next best thing? I'm very glad that they embrace digital. It sends a message to the ham radio world that we have a future, not just a glorious past. I should get some email on that. I do hope, though, that all the manufacturers are looking into designing radios that will do multiple digital formats, easily upgradable when new ones are invented, and they will be. Each digital system, Yaesu, ICOM, DMR, P25, each of the digital systems has a fan base. They'll adopt the systems. They may all thrive. Maybe one will win. I hope, though, that hams will take the longer view and look closely at what kinds of technology will be fun today, fun tomorrow, and help us reach our future. future. Helping me reach my future, sitting behind here watching all this stuff, is Arvin, the ARVN, Ham Radio Now, little piggy bank, asking you to stop by hamradionow.tv if you've enjoyed the program, gotten something out of it. All of you folks who didn't come from reading the QST article because it didn't point you here, but maybe you found your way here anyway. This is a program supported by you. If you did manage to find your way here just because of that QST article, there's a bunch of other programs, 160 other programs, over 200 actual other videos online from Ham Radio Now, and a bunch in the old ARVN.tv website that I haven't migrated over to Ham Radio Now. Something else I could point out, if I can get to the right page here. Over 4,000 subscribers. Come on. I'm having trouble making my mouse behave here. We have crossed the 4,000 subscriber line. And I guess I would also like to point out that I finally finished the graphic and artwork that YouTube wanted for the YouTube channel. This appears differently on each device you look at. This thing moves around, and will it move around if I zoom in? No, kind of stuck there for now. But if you look at it on a phone or on a tablet, it looks different. So I finally acknowledge that there's a lot going on YouTube and made the artwork for YouTube. So over 4,000 subscribers, 161 shows, over 200 actual videos. If you would like to help out, hamradionow.tv, see Arvin's icon, click on that, and you can help us financially. I'd like to thank the folks who have done that. A lot of folks have. Thank you very much. Thanks to the folks who supported the Kickstarter. It's just about time to start getting everything put together and heading on out to Austin, Texas, to record the Tapper Digital Communications Conference. So we're going to get ready for that. I don't know how many programs I'm going to be able to do between now and then. Going to be a lot of effort focused on getting things ready to go to Austin. Freelance is apparently still kind of wicked up. So when I've got a freelance day, I can't do much ham radio now. So many shows to do, so many things I would like to do. If this could be full-time, I do several a week. As it is now, I just do them when I can. I used to be able to do a lot of them. Right now, I'm kind of making money. I'm glad of it. So I guess that's it. I will see you whenever the next program comes out, hopefully soon. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ73. Thanks to Roland and Mike and Dave for helping me out down in Charlotte.
Over. It's our story, and we're sticking to it.
There you go.
Over and out.
I'll say over. You guys say and out.
And out.
Thanks, Gary. It was fun.